December 1st, 1940. The King and Queen of England might be in Canada, but at least one royal is coming back to Britain. The Duke of Windsor is returning to England to become Prince Regent, and Wallis Simpson will be his princess. Whilst Marshal von Brauchitz retains martial law in London and the South East, the Duke and Duchess will rule free Britain from Balmoral in Scotland.
With control of the British elite, the Nazis' next move would be to use the humble British bobby for their own ends. A chapter in Informationsheft GB gave the Nazis all the operational details they needed to assume control of the British police force.
It was noted by 1937 that many of London's police officers showed an interest in studying German. Criminal Investigation Division Chief Constable J.E. Horwell is an experienced and practical man who has always behaved in a pro-German manner and has always been helpful.
The book includes a comprehensive breakdown of the hierarchy of the Metropolitan Police Service. Also singled out for special attention was the Central Registry of Foreigners located at Bow Street Police Station, along with the collection of fingerprints on the third floor, which contained files on more than half a million people.
The reason they were so interested in the police is a question of manpower, that their own manpower wasn't sufficiently large to police any given country or city in detail. So what they would want to do would be to slip themselves into a sort of command position over collaborators within the indigenous police forces.
The Nazis even named Chief Constable J.E. Horwell as a potential collaborator. While we can never know if this individual would have cooperated, this was exactly the strategy employed by the Nazis all over occupied Europe.
They persuade people to acquiesce to this by appealing to their sense of duty, and that's quite an easy thing to do, because that's what people are used to. You say, well, you were the policeman before, we still need people to prevent crime from taking place. Crime is still going to take place. Forget the fact that we are the Nazis, we're the Germans, we're, you know, Mr. Hitler's horrible invaders. We still need you to do that job, and you will be helping your people by doing that job.
And it would have worked in Britain just as it had in the Channel Islands, as this extraordinary footage demonstrates.
They weren't traitors or anything like that, but the German orders came through, and it was a matter of the king's dead, long live the king. They had to just carry out orders. In fact, they arrested two or three policemen that refused to carry out some orders, and they put them in the local prison. But they had no choice. They'd have lost their job, their pension, and most would have ended up in the camp with their family, you see.
With the police force at their disposal, the Nazis could expand their persecution of the British public, from the individuals named in the Black Book to entire sectors of society. Informationsheft GB devotes an entire chapter to universities and enemy cultural institutions. So how would the Nazis have treated these distinguished seats of learning?
The Nazis would have regarded, rightly or wrongly, the universities in every country as sources of potential intelligent opposition. They would have sacked and replaced those academics who were very visible opponents of Nazism in general. In case of the libraries and so forth, they would have done presumably what they did themselves in May 1933 back in Germany, which is to sift through them and take out what they perceived to be subversive or degenerate books and make a bonfire of them in the Oxford quads.
December 12, 1940. Oxford University is purged by the SS. Over 20,000 books are burnt outside the Bodleian Library, and 17 academics arrested. Among them is philosopher Bertrand Russell, who is killed as he struggles to put out the flames.
The Germans' interest in the British educational system even extended to the major English boarding schools.
The Nazis were fascinated by the British elite education system, so public schools like Eton or Harrow or Winchester, and I think it's largely a reflection of their sense of inferiority. In other words, you know, this is the system that made the British a gigantic imperial power when we had no empire ourselves. And that's why I think in their occupation handbook they're so fascinated by the major public schools. I mean, Schoenberg actually notes the fact that Eton is fully booked up till 1949, so perhaps they were thinking of sending their own kids there.
England is the country of Freemasonry. What concerns us is that in its ideological orientation, it is a dangerous weapon in the hands of Britain's plutocrats against National Socialist Germany.
Informationsheft GB names more than 2,000 Freemasons' lodges across the United Kingdom. Despite the Masons' reputation for secrecy, they were accurately categorized and cross-referenced, and even included specialist university and military lodges. With these detailed lists, British Freemasonry would have been eradicated, just as it was in the Channel Islands.
It was on the morning of the 27th of January, 1941, that squads of special troops, professional wreckers, arrived here at the Masonic Temple in St. Helier and set about the systematic looting and pillaging of this beautiful building. They stripped out all the main furnishings, and they also stripped out and ransacked the splendid library and museum. And as photographs which are taken at the Liberation show, the damage inflicted was horrendous. It was state vandalism.
Well, in the French case, they organised a huge exhibition in Paris on the evils of Freemasonry as a conspiracy. And likewise, in Britain, they would have barged into big Masonic lodges and confiscated all the paraphernalia. They might well have made a big exhibition of all this stuff in the Guildhall with all sorts of photographs and information and line charts showing this great Masonic network allegedly running Britain and pointing out how many cabinet ministers or whatever were Masons. And they would have tried to sell that to the population, saying, look here, you idiots, you've been governed for years by 200 sort of leading Freemasons or something.
December 15th, Freemasonry is declared illegal in Britain. The Grand Lodge is ransacked and 80 high-ranking Freemasons are deported to concentration camps, while the Young Men's Christian Association is permanently disbanded.
The YMCA is described in Informationsheft GB as being entirely in the hands of the Freemasons. Other groups which the Nazis perceived to be a threat included the Church of England and the Salvation Army. Informationsheft GB also targeted communists and trades unions, and lists around 2,000 individual associations in Great Britain, even including groups as obscure as the Rossendale Union of Boot and Shoemakers. While all these groups would be banned and their leaders arrested, there was one minority who would be singled out above all others.
Cromwell was convinced his people were the chosen ones, just as the Jews were. This set the foundations for an Anglo-Jewish alliance. There is no exact estimate of the number of Jews living in England. Officially, there are said to be 300.